Herman Cain reveals the source of the sexual harassment story. You'll never guess. It's Herman Cain.
Remember, this happened 12 years ago.
Rick Perry and his campaign owe an apology.
Bring it. Herman Cain suddenly remembers that he used to remember the sexual harassment charges, and he used to tell people about them.
Excuse me. Excuse me.
The candidate is saying I told the guy the story.
Mr. Cain divulged the NRA claims at that time to his general consultant.
He's the anonymous source if he told Anderson himself.
Now he's recalling that he had a conversation specifically telling some guy about it several years ago.
You yourself briefed your campaign aide.
Didn't intend to contradict myself.
If that's the case, he just unmasked the anonymous source himself.
By his own statement to Forbes, this is information that he gave a guy.
Don't even bother asking me all of these other questions.
Herman Cain also remembers this.
I do recall that her performance was not up to par. I wasn't even aware of it. I am unaware. I was aware that an agreement was reached. Yes, that was some sort of settlement. What I knew and what I didn't know, there are legal implications. I just found out about this today. What I can now remember and what I couldn't remember.
That's what people like about him, because he doesn't
idiot. Republicans are worried about Herman Cain, but Democrats are worried about Mitt Romney.
We can't have any surprises with our candidate.
It's sort of disgusting.
There are a lot of reasons not to elect me.
It's not a very pretty picture, is it?
Mystery solved, Herman Cain style. Herman Sherlock Cain has figured out who leaked the Cain sexual harassment story that Politico broke on Sunday. Cain laid it all out to a friendly reporter at Forbes magazine. How friendly? The reporter was the author of this article last week, entitled, Why Herman Cain Has the Potential to Win. The story of intrigue and betrayal that Cain told Forbes begins in 2003 when our hero, Herman Cain, is running for the United States Senate in Georgia. In the summer of 2003, Cain recalls briefing Kurt Anderson, his general campaign consultant at the time, that sexual harassment claims were brought against him while he was chairman of the National Restaurant Association from 1996 to 1999. I told my wife about this in 1999, and I've got nothing to hide, Cain told me Wednesday. When I sat down with my general campaign consultant, Kurt Anderson, in a private room in our campaign offices in 2003, we discussed opposition research on me. I told him there was only one case, one set of charges, one woman, while I was at the National Restaurant Association. I don't recall anyone else being in the room when I told him. Only one woman. Talk about making a campaign consultant's day. Only one woman. When's the last time Kurt Anderson had a candidate with only one woman that he had to keep in the closet? Surely it couldn't be that one woman that motivated Kurt Anderson to work for the Perry presidential campaign this season instead of the Cain campaign. Herman Sherlock Cain is convinced that Kurt Anderson and the Perry campaign team leaked the sexual harassment story to Politico. The trouble with that is this statement released today by Kurt the Backstabber Anderson. I've known Herman Cain for about 7 years. I was one of several consultants on his Senate race in 2004 and was proud to help him. I'd never heard any of these allegations until I read them in Politico. Nor does anything I read in the press change my opinion that Herman Cain is an upstanding man and a gentleman. I have great respect for Herman and his character, and I would never speak ill of him on the record or off the record. That's true today, and it's not going to change. How classy is that? Herman Cain accuses Kurt Anderson of being a snake in the grass, a backstabber, a leaker about that one woman. And Kurt Anderson responds with such an elegant declaration that Herman Cain is a liar that people like Herman Cain and his followers won't even notice that Kurt Anderson just called Cain a liar. Kane says that he told Kurt Anderson about the accusations. Kurt Anderson says, no, he didn't. And then, after calling Kane a liar, Kurt Anderson throws in my favorite sentence of this presidential campaign. I have great respect for Herman and his character, and I would never speak ill of him. I would never speak ill of him, except right now when I'm calling him a liar. Herman Cain has never had to spin a scandal to the Washington Press Corps before, so don't be surprised if he forgets a lot of what he said from one interview to the next. And don't start feeling like super sleuth to just because you can remember way back to, you know, yesterday when Herman Cain was saying he hadn't thought about this in 12 years. All he's saying now is he hadn't thought about it in 8 years. Big deal. 12 years, 8 years. What's the difference? But we know for sure Herman Cain and his mastermind campaign strategist, you know, this guy. Yeah, that's the guy, Mark Block. You know, that every day of the last 12 days of Herman and Mark's excellent adventure has been spent thinking about those sexual harassment charges every waking minute, because Politico first asked them about it 12 days ago. And what you've seen from Monday morning to now is the Cain story changing by the hour. 10 days of scheming with his campaign mastermind was not enough to prepare Herman Cain for what was to come when Politico published that story. Cain and his camera-hungry campaign genius are tired of talking about charges and confidentiality agreements. They want to talk about who's really to blame for all this.
The actions of the Perry campaign are despicable. Rick Perry and his campaign owe Herman Cain and his family an apology. Both the Rick Perry campaign and Politico did the wrong thing by reporting something that wasn't true from anonymous sources.
Herman and Mark don't just have a Kurt Anderson problem, now they have a Chris Wilson problem. Chris Wilson is a Republican consultant who is also linked to Rick Perry and has conducted polling for a super PAC that supports Perry. Chris Wilson does remember something about Herman Cain and sexual harassment. The sexual harassment that he witnessed with his own eyes.
I was the pollster for the National Restaurant Association when Herman Cain was the head of it. And I'll tell you, I was actually around a couple of times where this happened. And anyone who was involved with the Restaurant Association at the time knew that this was going to come up. At the time, she was a very lower level staffer. I think she was maybe 2 years out of college. And this all occurred at a restaurant in Crystal City, and everybody was very aware of it. And so it was only a matter of time, because so many people were aware of what took place. So many people were aware of her situation and the fact that she left after this. If she does go on the air and talk about it, I think it'll be the end of this campaign.
Chris Wilson later told Politico that Cain's actions at the restaurant made others present uneasy. It was very uncomfortable, said the pollster, recalling that other individuals present asked Cain to stop. Conservative radio talk show host Steve Deese, who hosts a nationally syndicated show in Des Moines, told Politico that Cain said inappropriate things to staff at his radio station. Like awkward, inappropriate things he said to two females on my staff, that the fact the guy's wife is never around. The Associated Press reports that a third unidentified female employee for the National Restaurant Association considered filing, though never filed, a complaint against Herman Cain for what she considered aggressive and unwanted behavior, including a private invitation to his corporate apartment. NBC News has not confirmed that AP story. Cain has been making the rounds of friendly Fox News interviews, but has much less to say when confronted by real reporters.
Let me say one thing. I'm here with these doctors, and that's what I'm gonna talk about. So don't even bother asking me all of these other questions that you all are curious about, okay? Don't even bother.
It's a good question, though.
But are you concerned about the fact that these women do want to, that
what did I say?
Wants to come forward? Are you concerned about?
Excuse me. Excuse me. No, don't. Some people understand.
What part of no don't some people understand? maybe the part that means, no, I don't want you to sexually harass me in the office right now. Herman Cain met Georgia House Republicans today at the Capitol. According to Politico, Cain said he and his campaign had found out who was purportedly leaking word of his behavior toward female employees at the National Restaurant Association, and that a report was coming out that would disprove the charges, according to the chief of staff to one of the Georgia members. Joining me now, MSNBC political analyst and author of Revival, The Struggle for Survival Inside the Obama White House, Richard Wolff, also MSNBC and Time.com contributor, author of Who's Afraid of Post-Blackness, Turay. Thank you both for joining me tonight.
Thank you.
Thanks, Lawrence.
So, Turay, there's a report coming out. The Cain campaign, I have this funny feeling that this report is going to come out at exactly the same time that Donald Trump's important report from his investigators in Hawaii comes out. Should we be holding our breath for the report from the Cain campaign?
I would not be holding our breath. I mean, we don't see them dealing with this in a forthright way at all. It's certainly not a presidential way. It's not even really a professional way to deal with it as a politician. But this is a major moment for the GOP because Cain is a really important candidate, perhaps more important than any of the other candidates, because he serves a massive psychological purpose. Because there's a lot of people in the GOP who've been critical of Obama and have been made to feel that they are racist because of their criticism. Some of it has been racist, some of it's been reasonable, some of it's been business as usual Republican-Democrat stuff, okay. Cain comes along offering salvation, liberation. You're not racist if you support Herman Cain. So now they have this Herman Cain card that they can throw at us anytime they are made to feel racist. So this is like a beautiful thing for them. So they need him to succeed as long as they can deal with him so that they can get their Cain card and make it as valuable as possible. But of course, this whole transaction is a canard.
In what way?
Well, I mean, Cain is giving comfort to racists in the way that he purports himself, as we've discussed before on this show. So, I mean, this is not the person that you can hold up as, well, see, I'm not a racist, I love Herman Cain.
Right. Richard, how long can Cain keep this going?
Oh, he can sustain his own misery for a very long time if he carries on like this. You know, the interesting thing here is that people talk about vetting. You know, the idea that candidates need to be vetted. The vetting in this question, in this whole process, is not actually whether you've got the skeletons in the closet or that unfortunate employee that you harassed out of a job. The vetting is, how do you deal with the pressure? You know, are you up to it? Can you deal with a fluid situation where your advisors are over here and the press is over there? Because that in some way simulates the ridiculousness of being in the Oval Office. And clearly, this man has failed. He's failed badly. As you pointed out, he had 12 days to prepare it. He hasn't got his story straight. He's failed vetting, not just because he has this dirty secret that he's trying to hide, but actually because he's not up to doing anything but the marketing slogan of 999. You strip that away, there's no there.
Now, he's said that there's going to be a report coming out that will prove all this stuff is fake. He's also said that we're going to be meeting his wife soon, presumably through some friendly interview venue at Fox News. Let's listen to what Herman Cain said on Meet the Press about his wife on October 16th.
Let me tell you why you haven't seen my wife. I'm running a different kind of a campaign. My wife and I, we have a family life. And she is maintaining the calmness and the tranquility of that family life. So when I do get a day off of the campaign trail, I can go home and enjoy my family. Secondly, I don't want to subject my wife and my family to the rigors and the attacks and the criticism of this campaign at this point.
Turay, how much should Cain really fight this? He's not going to be president. He's not going to get the nomination. He's not going to be on anyone's vice presidential slot in the ticket. There's nothing at stake here other than preserving his marketability as a motivational speaker and whatever deal he can get from Fox News at the end of the trail. I mean, how long should he drag this out? Should he pull his wife out in front of the cameras to defend him? Should he go through all the motions that a regular politician goes through?
Well, I think you do. I think that you try to stretch it out as long as you can, because as you said, it's not a real campaign. It's about selling books, raising the price as a motivational speaker, seeing what you can get out of media like Fox News. So you're allowed to be a free swinger, because it doesn't really matter what is coming at you. It just, how long can I stay on the stage as a potentially or ostensibly viable candidate? So as long as you can stay on there,
then, you know, keep going.
But, Richard, as Sarah Palin can tell him, losing candidates have to prepare themselves for whatever industry they're going to find themselves in after the campaign.
Yeah.
Isn't he on the verge of doing enough damage to himself that he really won't have much marketability after this?
No, because there's more of a freak show out there that he can make money from. And look, Sarah Palin monetized her brief moment in the spotlight pretty well. You know, you're right, it's not a real campaign, so maybe none of this stuff matters, especially when unemployment is where it is and the world is facing so many serious challenges. But he says something.